So one of the songs you chose, it was a Stephen Sondheim song called Finishing the Hat from Sunday in the Park with George, which is a show that I discovered at NYU. And, you know, it blew my mind when I first saw it. I now have, I think, some mixed feelings about it, but this song is indisputably a masterpiece. It's a masterpiece of a song. And yeah, I just remember the first time I saw the video of Mandy Patinkin performing it, you know, like the the Broadway tape, whatever, bootleg or whatever it is. Maybe that was from television. And the entire first act just blew my mind.
Yeah, yeah. It's one of those, I feel like Sondheim has a few shows like that where they're like, the first act is perfect. And then the second act,
For those who don't know the show is about, it's a fictionalized look at the, you know, a day or month or whatever, a week in the life of Georges Seurat, the pointillist French painter, as he's completing his most famous painting, I guess. It would be, Sunday on the Isle of Grand Jatte, which is, you can see it in Chicago at the art museum there. Anyway, it sort of depicts the events leading up to the creation of that work. And then the first act culminates with that image, that iconic image being created on stage live, which is a remarkable effect. But he was a pointillist, meaning that, what is the technique? Basically just dots, right?
Lots of little tiny dots. No, but Finishing the Hat is another one of those songs that I have used frequently as like, let's do an in-depth study of this in lyric classes. And like I said, I was tempted to pull up my PowerPoint because I have all kinds of pithy.
Well, please give it to us. I'd love to hear the PowerPoint of your, like the, you know, the distillation of your PowerPoint. How do you go about teaching this song? What do you point out to students who are studying lyrics?
Oh gosh. Well, I really go kind of line by line looking at it. But I can maybe hit a few of the highlights. One thing I talk about is the kind of the way even the phrase lengths work in the main A sections, where it's like finishing the hat, how you have to finish the hat. Watch the rest of the world, and the way that it's extending the same idea. It's, you know, adding to the front of it. And to me, I was like, this is almost kind of like an artist process of like, kind of like sketching something in and extending and developing it. I was like, it's a very like artist type of approach to the way he's developing the idea there.
Finishing the hat, how you have to finish the hat, how you watch the rest of the world from a window while you finish the hat.
And it's,
well,
there.
This is his content dictates form maxim.
Yeah.
In action, you know, because the song, when I listen to it, there is a kind of obsessive curly Q feeling to the way the lyric unspools and then goes further.
That longer and longer phrase.
And it's a song about obsession. It's about, and it's about the wages of obsession, the consequences of it, the costs of it, and the thrills and the joys of that dedication to,
like, on a very basic level, you know, the conflict between his passion for his art, for his art making, versus any other relationship, in this case specifically Dot or the woman, you know, referred to in the song. And
the,
it's like very clearly laid out in the, like, the A sections are about his focus and attention to his art, and the B sections are where he kind of regretfully says, like, you know, yeah, I have to let that go, or, you know, thinks about how that would pull him away from his work, but then he always comes back.
Yeah. Is it regretful or rueful or just kind of like, there's a kind of inevitability about it. He's like, well, be that as it may.
Yeah.
This is who I am. And in fact, it's how he gets into the song in the first place, right? Because it starts with that little pitter patter intro.
Me. Yeah.
She waits for me, blah, blah, blah. Some other thing. Good. Let her wait for me, you know? Yeah. And then I thought she might, and it, like, underneath the surface, you get that he actually cares. He's like, there's a bit of resentment.
Yeah, exactly. That she is a little different from That verse intro, I do a thing on the verse intro too. Well, first of all, I point out like how many times the word me appears in that. Yes, she looks for me. Good, let her look for me to tell her why she left me. As I was, you know, like you get George is very self-involved. And actually the rhyme scheme of that little verse intro, all the ouds, every single one is ood. It's kind of like speaks to a certain like maniacal focus, the way like, no reason why she should, would, but if anybody.
But if anybody could.
Yeah.
Yes, she looks for me. Good. Let her look for me to tell me why she left me, as I always knew she would. I had thought she understood. They have never understood, and no reason that they should. But if anybody could.
All those
well, and the show does his narcissism no favors, because the most repeated word at the end of any verse, any lyric in the entire show is George.
Yeah.
Sunday in the park with George.
All right, George.
Who was at the zoo, George?
As long as it's your night, George.
I love your eyes, George.
George looks around. George is alone. George is afraid. George too may fade.
The monkeys and who, George?
George sees the park.
I love your beard, George.
George is aground.
You are complete, George.
You know what's in the room, George.
Never know with you, George.
George has outgrown.
George. Like your eyes, George. I like your thighs, George. I like your size, George.
Yeah. So I get into the weeds of it really with finishing the hat, the title alone. I was like, the hat is very specifically chosen because it's this like pointillistic word, you know, hat, and he does more of that later in the hat and the dog and the stick and the, you know, all these like short single syllable hard consonant ending things.
And how you're always turning back to from the grass and the stick and the dog and the light.
However, then I talk about like the kind of progression and like, you know, when you're in an AABA form and you're going to do multiple A's, like how are they different from each other? How is it progressing? And we look at like the first A is finishing the hat, how you have to finish the hat. Second one is like finishing sky, what you like mapping a sky. And my point there is just like, It's more expansive as imagery, of course. It's now we're talking about the sky, but it's also literally like an open vowel now. Yes. And the singer is going to hold that word out. Whether, yeah. You know, finishing a sky.
Mapping out a sky. What you feel like planning a sky. What you feel when voices that come through the window go until they distance and die. Until there's nothing but sky.
So the song literally opens out in that second A.
One other sense in which this second A section creates a sense of expansion, as Pete is talking about, and I just noticed this when putting this together, it contains the song's very first rhyme, at least since the verse intro with all the good, should, understood stuff. But up until now, it's been finishing the hat, how you have to finish the hat, how you watch the rest of the world through a window while you finish the hat, mapping out a sky, what you feel like planning a sky. You hear the sort of insistent, sort of repeated hammering away on the objects of his focus and attention, which is totally appropriate. But here he says, what you feel when voices that come through the window go until they distance and die, until there's nothing but sky. Something happens in the ear, I think even in the body, when that rhyming word comes along, when there's a match finally for that sound, where we can start to relax and expand. And it's a very subtle and powerful sensitivity that a lyricist like this has to the effect of rhymes versus repetitions.
I talk a lot about the window, of course, the window that's there every single time, right?
But the it starts as a literal window.
Well, yeah, and every single time the progression is very well thought out as far as like, what is the first one? Let's see, voices that come through the window and go until they distance and die, or is that the second one?
I thought that's the first one is watching the world through a window.
Yeah, so the second one, yeah. He's still like turning away from his work.
The world is a distraction. The world is just a distraction.
Second one, he's not looking out the window, but the voices come through and they distance and die. So he's getting like pulled away from the outside world. Then it later becomes like a window. You look through the window into the world of your art, you know? And then finally, like the window becomes like the distancing, because he talks, you know, it becomes about Dot and how he has to like keep a distance from her and from all of the world to have an artist's perspective, you know, leaves a little space in the way, like a window,
right?
You know, he can't ever be he can't be intimate with another person because he has to be his aloof, perfect artist, godlike perspective. And that's what the window becomes by the end of the song.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just amazing. It's there like maybe 5-6 times in the song, and each time it has a different spin on how he uses that word.
How do you feel the
musically, it's that point that every single A section gets to that's very highlighted with the chord that it lands on there.
And there's one time where he it's not just he goes window, da.
That's the second one. Yeah, the voices that come through the window go. Nice little echo of the rhyme there, the O sound.
Yeah. It's very nice. How do you feel about the scan of what you feel like painting a sky? What you feel like painting a sky?
I guess he's talking about like things that are awesome about being an artist. Mapping out a sky, what you feel like mapping, you know.
No, I'm just talking about the scan here, the prosody.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be more natural to say how it feels to finish a sky or something like that? Even better, you could say how you feel when planning a sky. But really, actually, this is completely moot. Any actor worth a damn is going to imply that comma with their phrasing, which is totally fair game. You don't have to be robotic about following the exact note. So it would be something like, what you feel like planning a sky, which is basically how Mandy Patinkin does it. So, I mean, what am I even talking about?
Yeah, and I bet if we,
you know, I'm just looking for a little chink in his armor, because I'm always looking to take him down a notch. He's so good.
That guy. Oh, another thing I always talk about is there's one little musical phrase that kind of is not part of either the A or the B section, so to speak. It's the part where he goes, but to see, it's the only way to see. It's, which I think is almost like the turning point of the song, actually, where he decides like that, you know, pushing her away, you know, not getting involved with her, sacrificing the relationship is the choice he makes to be an artist.
Yeah.
But I always think it's like, to me, musically, it's a C-section. And I was like, isn't it funny that he used the lyric, but to see, it's the only way.
That's very inside lyric ball. I like that, though. To see, it's the only way to see. And that's what launches him into the final statement.
But to see, it's the only way to see. And when the woman that you wanted goes, you can say to yourself, well, I give what I give. But the woman who won't wait for you knows that however you live, there's a part of you always standing by, mapping out the sky. Finishing a hat. Starting on a hat. Finishing a hat. Look, I made a hat.
And then, look, I made a hat where there never was a hat. There's that famous line.
Where there never was a hat.
And notice in that little coda, the window's gone. The window that was the only thing that would take him away from his work, the only distraction, the outside world. That coda is just da 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 da. It's just the work now, you know? The window has disappeared. Ooh, I was looking at the PowerPoint. I found one other little tidbit I always like to point out is the little kind of verbal game that gets us out of the B section, the first one. So he's going along how the kind of woman willing to wait's not the kind that you want to find waiting to return you to the night, dizzy from the height coming from the hat, which to me is almost like one of those little like word transformations where you change a single letter each time until you know,
night
turns height turns to hat. So it's like gravitational pull pulling you back to the A section, which is
so. Hold on, let's break this down. You're always turning back too late from the grass or the stick or the dog or the light. So you know you're you've been at the easel too long. How the woman, how the kind of woman willing to waits, not the kind you want to find waiting to return you to the night. What's he saying there? Is he talking about passionate women versus steadfast women? What's the, what do you make of that?
That I do get a little lost in that, because I mean the turnabout of the words is so wonderful, with the kind of woman willing to wait, not the kind you want to find waiting. All the W's and the little inversion there is great. But I'll admit, like, it's not totally clear to me what he means by to return you, because it's all one clause. You know, it's all part of one mega sentence. To return you to the night, dizzy from the height, coming from the hat. Like,
right, because you might think to return you to the night, dizzy from the height, like, the kind of woman willing to wait, it's not the kind you want to go have a quick roll in the hay with before you go back to the easel or something. Like, she's not going to be the one to like satisfy that passion in you. But you're right, coming from that, I don't quite follow.
I actually think I follow it now, sort of. So there's a type of woman who's willing to wait, like Pete said, but that's not the type of woman that you want to find waiting for you returning to the night, as in, you know, rejoining the real world, dizzy from the height of painting and creating, coming from the hat, coming from the detailed, focused, concentrated work. You want a different kind of woman. I'm not exactly sure what different kind of woman, maybe someone with a bit more self-respect, more presence, more verve, more passion than, you know, a self-sacrificing, endlessly patient partner. Maybe?
Yeah, well, and Dot ultimately proves to be the kind who is not willing to wait. I think he's saying that she is the more worthwhile kind, but he knows that she will not wait for him. You know, she will not be at his beck and call.
It's an ironic thing for him that his match is not the one, is the one that he can't match with, because he's not the guy. He's committed to being the hat finisher, not the love nurturer.
Yeah, it's so clear most of the time in its thesis, but so kind of uniquely expressed. That's what I love about it.
It's a very, very
land on a title like that, finishing the hat, you know, where it's about that, the work, and it's about the details, those pointless little details and the perfection.
And of course, many people, you know, that song has become very associated with him and his work, not just because he named his treatise on lyric writing about it, but because he is that guy. He is that obsessive, detail-oriented, all about the work artist. And sometimes I find myself relating to it. You know, like sometimes when I'm in the throes of a project or working on this channel, it can feel like I could finish that hat for hours, mm-hmm. and I'll be disappointed when I have to go back into the night where the hat isn't, because nothing turns you on like in the same way as the detail oriented parts of the creative process. You know, I can relate. I didn't think I could relate. I didn't used to think I could
think
relate,
that but must
I can.
Be what it's saying. I hope that's what it's saying.
Yeah, I think so.
Right.
Yes, she looks for me. Good. Let her look for me to tell me why she left me, as I always knew she would. I had thought she understood. They have never understood, and no reason that they should. But if anybody could, finishing the hat, how you have to finish the hat, how you watch the rest of the world from a window while you finish the hat, mapping out a sky, what you feel like planning a sky, what you feel when voices that come through the window go until the distance and die.
Until there's nothing but sky, and how you're always turning back too late from the grass or the stick or the dog or the light.
Not the kind of woman willing to wait. Not the kind that you'd like to find waiting to return you tonight. Dizzy from the height, coming from the hat, studying a hat, entering the world of a hat,
reaching through the world of the hat like a window, back to this one from that, studying a face, and stepping back to look at the face, leaves a little space in the way, like a window, but to see.
It's the only way to see. When a woman that you wanted goes, you can say to yourself, well, I give what I give. But a woman who won't wait for you knows that however you live, there's a part of you always standing by, laughing out the sky. Finishing a hat, starting on a hat, finishing a hat, look, I made a hat.